Yeah, which is named now NKDB, was named Opencouch, then dcouch, but I removed any couch from it. And it's now called NKDB. Nki is a Mesopotamian god, which is mostly an hacker because he was transforming words in power, just like exactly we are doing. Good morning, everyone. Just to introduce myself quickly, I'm a CouchDB core committer, working mostly on the core and also on the Couch app. I'm also a Python developer and Python member of the foundation. And mostly known for Unicorn, which is a WSGI HTTP server, which is used by a lot of people today. So today I will talk to you about NKDB, which is a database behind Campio, a new service I'm launching. And I will show you first why we are using Erlangs to build database. Secondly, why I decided to create my own database after many tries I will show you, and why Mnesia didn't fit the job. So first, why using Erlangs to build a database? So I won't talk to you about I/O problem, etc., because there are some I/O problems, but that's not that bad, at least for most of purpose. If you want real time, you won't use Erlangs anyway, but for most cases, it's enough. I will specifically speak about three challenges that you have to solve when you are building a database. First one, when we define a database, for me, this is mostly a software that that allows you to collect the data, store them, but not storing them as simple blobs, because this is quite another problem, more simply than database, but storing them in a way that you can retrieve them later, that you can query them later, which is quite more complicated. The other challenge that you need to solve when you are creating a database is concurrency. When I'm speaking about concurrency, I'm speaking about about being able to read while someone is writing data, or being able to read and write quite in the same series. The other challenge we speak about is ACID transactions. So what ACID stands for, the A is for atomicity, the I is for atomicity, the C is for consistency, the E is for isolation, and D is for durability. What is atomicity? First, what is a transaction? A transaction is mostly a set of operations that you are sending to the database that are you can have multi-transaction concurrent. You can have multi-concurrent transaction. Each transaction is a list of operations, of read operation and write operation. Then they must happen in order, because if you read the data and write later, you want to read it in first and then write later. And if you need to read back this data and rewrite it another data from it, you want to have read and write in the right order. And atomicity is just about that. This is all or nothing. So if you send multiple read and write in the same transaction, if one fails, then everything fails and you go back instead, which is the consistency is about. We'll show you later why. And Erlang is really well designed for that. We can imagine to have one process that maintains a transaction. And as you know, you can have many processes you want in Erlangs. And if you are using a Jet server, for example, you can just call a transaction or send a message to the Jet server. Each transaction will then be blocked, and the transaction will happen or not happen, and you will be able to retrieve it later, because Erlang is designed in a way that your process really fails fast. It fails fast, so you are able to recover it later using monitoring or stuff like it. Erlang has also this philosophy of let it crash, which is really what is about the all or nothing. Let it crash means that instead of doing like in many languages using trying to catch the error or raise some error from somewhere, you just let your process crash and recover it later or do nothing. It depends on what you want to do. Here, for the atomicity, we will be able to recover the state, recover the crash, know that your process crashed, and say, let's go to the last state where your database didn't read a value or didn't write a value in the transaction, because your first write may happen, but the second write won't happen. In that case, we consider that the first write shouldn't have happened, and we are going back in the transaction. We are going back to the latest state before the transaction. Consistency, this is what I'm saying. This is about checking the database from one state to the another and keeping this state very stable. So when you are reading your data at some point, this is because all the write that happened before happened in the right order. And the same for write. When you want to write after a read, you want it to read on a real state, on the latest database value, if you want to speak in closure world or like datomic. And like I said, process recovery helps for that. Isolation. So transactions should happen in order. If you have a list of reads followed by write, then followed by read in a transaction, they should all happen in order. And they should all happen in order. But of course, at the same time, you have not one transaction, but you have many transactions that happen concurrently on your server. And you want isolation is about to have all these transactions happen in a serial order. Even if you have many concurrent transactions, all your transactions will happen in a serial order. So if you have one transaction that makes read on the when you start a transaction, you take the latest state of your database, the latest database value that you have. If it's a B-tree, this is the latest root that you have in your B-tree. And you take this value, make a read on that, continue your transaction, write your data, continue the transaction, read. And the other transaction will do the same. And most of the time, this is solved in non-analog worlds by using locks. So you are looking on write or you are looking on read. It depends how, what you want to do. Generally, today, we are looking on read rather than looking on write because it allows you to replicate over the world. But in analog worlds, you can do it. You can do it by using message passing. And I'm speaking about Erlang's words, but in Linux world today, they are also using message passing for that. If you see BTRFS, which is a B-tree on your file systems, the kernel is sending message to your file system, and file system is sending message to the kernels that are passed to the file driver. And depending on the message, if he's waiting for read or if he's waiting for write, it will continue the transaction or fail, etc. And this is what you can do in Erlang. The fact that also processes, if you have a process that is managing a transaction, this process doesn't share anything with other process. They are completely isolated. So it means that you can fail on a transaction while the other transaction will continue. And you can also recover a transaction if it's what you want, while the other process will stop. You can send a message to the other process to stop its own transaction, etc., etc. So each process are isolated, and Erlang is very well designed to maintain scalability. The D for durability means that once you have made a transaction, everything is finished. When a transaction returns, all the read that you made in your transaction, all the write that you made in transaction are finished. And your database has a new state. And it won't change anymore. You can go back on your transaction and redo it. Your transaction is finished. And Erlang's reliability allows you to maintain this durability. Because if your process crash, then you were able to recover the latest state. If your process doesn't crash, then you know that your process finished, came down by monitoring it or whatever, and then you can continue another transaction or just crash everything if something really bad happened. So in short, Erlang is really well designed to build a database, in fact. And this is why we are using it. Of course, we have trade-off. Of course, we have slow I/O sometimes on the file systems. K can be improved. For example, if you're using the, if you're opening your files, if you're managing a database with a file, if you're opening with a row option rather than using the file IO server, which is giving you latency or whatever on the systems. But most of the time, this is quite enough and quite better with Erlang 16 or Erlang 17. Since the file driver is working well on Windows now, at least better than it was. So Erlang is well designed for database, and this is why you have some databases like React, like CouchDB, like many other databases written in Erlang. But in Campaigner, we needed a specific database. Like a reservator, which we started with CouchDB, of course, because obviously because I'm a CouchDB developer, but we ended by creating a new database in Erlang. So what is Campaigner exactly? Campaigner is about to allows you to have some data at some place, and when you need at another place, for example, if you have an office in New York, and you have another office in Singapore, and you want to have some data, we are able to replicate them to you, but we are not also replicating the data because this is just a CDN. We also allows you to take some snapshot, filtering the data, querying it, writing it at another place, being able to handle your data offline. So for example, if you are, if you have a multiple office around the world that for some reason, confidentiality or whatever, need to work on the data offline, then getting back online and resynchronizing the data, we are able to do that too. Because having data is not enough, we also need a way to process them. And I don't think that big silos, big data is the real solution. And I'm not the only one to think that. Even Google is in its new architecture as creating multiple local server, multiple local storage that are able to synchronize between themselves rather than using a big silos at one place or two place or three place and trying to replicate these big data silos. Even for processing, when we are speaking about Hadoop today, and when we are speaking about MapReduce, MapReduce is about handling mapping to take the data at some point, putting it on the server that will process the map function. So we are putting the data near the functions, executing the functions, sending back the data to another function. So if you want to combine or if you want to remap the data, etc., we are moving the data around the server. And the only reason we have these big data silos today, this is mostly because of network latency or electricity or power budget. But today this is changing. If we are talking today about sending some data from Beijing to New York, this is quite faster. This is maybe 100 times faster than it was 5 years ago. So we don't really need to have everything at the same place. We don't really need to have all these tools that manage these big data. What we really need is a way to localize the data. Where are your data? We need to a way to create rendezvous between the data points and sending them to the other nodes that need it for processing or using the data, etc. And this is what Campaigner is about. And if you take with the history gives me reason about that. All these big data silos that were in the past, here this is the library of Alexandria that burnt, Babel, etc., all disappeared. All these big data places disappeared. Where, at the same point, at the same moment, these small decentralized data points that were monasteries, keeping data, making replica of your data, copying the data from one thing to the another, taking snapshot, improving it, passing it to another things. We didn't invent anything today. We just put some technical means on what was doing by hands before, just because we are more than 7 billion of people on the earth today publishing content and monitoring contents. But this is the only reason why we are using computer for that. But the job is the same. What worked in the past was having small data silos, being able to replicate, and some guys knowing where these books was and being able to transport this book to another place in a secure manner. And this is, in my opinion, what is the future of data computing. So Campaio, in short, this is allows you to take the control back of your data. We won't store anything. We will allow you to use any store you want. We just provide you the way to manage that, the protocol you need to replicate the data. And for that, we needed a specific, we had specific requirements on database. Queries should be decentralized, and they should be decentralized in a way that you are being able to replicate some snapshot of data, some database value at some point, and keeping it in your office. And if I take an example, if you have, European university that like to work with small data by laboratory, and have this big data center somewhere that is storing that for archive or simply for sharing to the other. And this is what we want. One way to solve that in a decentralized manner is to have all these data silos in each laboratories, and have a way to know that this laboratory has this data and the other laboratory is able to take this data and replicate them or query them locally in its own laboratory, which was perfectly in Europe, because in Europe, budgets are per laboratory and not big big budget. So today we are spending a lot of money in laboratories to pay a company to host a lot of data simply for sharing with other laboratories, where here each budget can be used per laboratory to keep its own data and just have a way to share them with other laboratories. We want also a way to be able to do the query offline. If I take my computer or if I have my mobile, I need to be able to query this data locally, even if I'm offline, if I have no network. And this is what I don't invent anything today. This is quite possible, but we want to do a way to improve it. I don't have it on my phone, but I'm doing it with CouchDB. I ported Erlang to Android and iOS. Not like launching a script somewhere in Erlang, etc. We are really launching an Erlang release on your device, and we are sharing the process with a native application, so you are able to handle that in your application. And we are using, for a customer, I ported CouchDB to iOS, CouchDB in Erlang to iOS and Android, and we are simply replicating data from them. But like I will show you, this, wasn't pleased with that. We also need to be able to query when we are disconnected from the other nodes without knowing that this data is in this place and this data is in another place. I need to be able to have all the data in place and being able to work on that, do any query I want, pass any script I want. Same from write. We need to have the write happen independently of reads. So if someone is able to query the data, etc., we want to be on the other one to be able to have local write. So if I'm disconnected, if I'm offline, I'm able to write on my database. And when I came back online, replicating this data with the write server, with the storage service. But I also need to sometimes to centralize the write at some point. So I need a way to have a simple writer, simple updater, different from the reader. And we also need to support transactions. And this is one of the reasons we didn't use CouchDB. In CouchDB, transaction is per document. You are storing a document or you are not storing it. We want to be able at some point to store one document based on the database value, based on other documents, maybe change the value of the document or sending new operations to my database. This is what we want to be able to do. And Mnesia partly fits the bills in a way that we have replication in Mnesia, but we are speaking about replication in Mnesia. This is mostly about a way to replicate to the node where we can write. We cannot replicate to the node we can't write on it. Where in Enki, where in Campaio, we want to be able to replicate between nodes by that we only need to read on that. We need Mnesia has location transparency. I mean, you don't know where to write. You have simply nodes where you can write, and you and Mnesia will handle for you the write, sending to the node, sending to the replica it needs. You have this-less mode in React, in Mnesia, so you don't have to have an hard disk on your machine. You can store it on the remote nodes. And we have transaction supports in Mnesia with real-time capabilities, meaning that by that Mnesia is able to choose the lock in real time between all the nodes that you have in your Erlang cluster, which is pretty nice. But because there is a big but, like I said, the replication only works between nodes where you can write. You have no offline capabilities. If you disconnect Mnesia from your network, you won't be able to recover. You won't be able to work on your data, except you will have only part of your data on your nodes. And we don't want that. And transaction imply a dialogue between all the nodes on the cluster. And we don't want that. So we want to be able to have one. We want to make sure that all the nodes that are part of the same update of the same storage are being able to discuss at the same times. There are some trade-offs I will show you later. So Mnesia wasn't for us, in fact. And a bit of history. We started by using CouchDB compared to Mnesia, not for all the reasons I gave. The first reason was Mnesia, a long time, 1 year ago, 2 years ago, wasn't able to handle that database higher than 2 gigabytes on your hard disk. And we needed to bypass this limit. And this is why also CouchDB is not based on Mnesia, but based on its own B-tree, because Damian, which created Mnesia, CouchDB, was trying to use Mnesia as a data storage, but failing in this limit, and decided to write his own B-tree. Interesting thing that we have in CouchDB, we have master-master replication, which means that every node is able to write, every node is able to replicate. We don't have the concept of master-slave. Conflict can happen, but conflict are stored transparently on each node, and this is your application that will have to solve the conflicts. Sometimes you don't need to solve conflicts, and in fact, this is the branch. I will talk about that later. You have also view indexation, which is map reduced, but an incremental map reduced per nodes. So you can map all your data. Instead of adding index on a key or on a value, you just pass the key and the value to a function, which can be in JavaScript, in Erlang, or any language you want. And you emit the key and the value you want to be to query later in your index. You are creating your index dynamically, but indexes are stored on the disk. So the next time you call an index, you won't redo all the work that you are doing in SQL. You will query an index on the file system, which is quite faster, at least on read, and when you don't have to calculate a lot of data. And you have a modern storage. The CouchDB B-tree, I will describe it later, but this is mostly copy and write B-tree systems, append-only system, really well optimized for SSD. So a lot of interesting things in CouchDB. The Refuge project started in 2011 during the Chaos Computer Camp. And we started by hacking CouchDB The goal was at this point to have a small box based on plug computer because we didn't have a Raspberry at this time. So we have put CouchDB on plug computer, and the goal was to replicate this plug computer around the camp and doing some stuff with sensors, replicating data from a sensor on a node and replicating to another computer and replicating to finally to your laptop, and you were able to, for example, get all the humidity in the fields on your computer by replicating from one plug computer on which you plugged the sensor to another plug computer that were storing the data finally to your to the computer where you were doing the graph or doing anything you wanted. So it was a CouchDB hack because we had to hack it to work on ARM and stuff like it. Was really hard to deploy. And we needed to make it to have a real Erlang release, so we built one release and deploy on all plug computers at the same time. And CouchDB was and still is, even if work is working on that, based on auto tools, was not creating an Erlang release, but installing modules on your path, on the file system path, and launching using a shell script all the Erlang's VM. And this is quite complicated when you want to deploy the same image to a disk. You can also do today using Docker or Elixir or whatever, but in 2011 it wasn't really possible. And well, Erlang release are designed for that. So we decided to hack CouchDB to make it more OTP to be able to create Erlang release, so we have refactored all the CouchDB code, make it more robust to fail to failure, changing the supervision, and finally creating a release, adding new feature like the view change. I spoke about the index, and in CouchDB you are able to listen on database change in real times, or in quite real times. So you know when a document is deleted on your database or when a document is added to your database by listening on HTTP on an HTTP resource. So people that want to do some tricky stuff today with CouchDB are using multiple databases so they can split the data. For example, if you want a database per user, you want data per user, people are creating database per user, so they can isolate the data for, per user, and replicate from one data from one master database to each user database using a filter, which works, but can't really scale. Wouldn't it be cool instead to have a simple index on which you can listen change, and it can also be used to make something like Hadoop, having some index on different place, incremental index on which you can do a real map reduce on each node. So this is called what we call the view change. The view change is a way to listen on the index change in quite real times. And we added that to our cache. And this is a work in progress. This is merged back in Apache CouchDB. And we will probably be part of the last stable release of CouchDB with the cluster things. We wasn't pleased about that. One of the reasons is because we have to maintain our own forks, porting each change to our couch, which was quite difficult at some point. At some times, we had 2 months. We had to put 2 months of change in CouchDB. Hopefully, CouchDB has not so much activity, so it's quite reasonable. But was annoying. Also, we weren't able to completely embed it in our own Erlang applications. We have to do a lot of hack around it, mostly because CouchDB is using an ini file, for example. So we have to find a way to create the ini file each time with our own applications, even if we don't use the ini file for anything other than the CouchDB store. Stuff like this. We also need a simple API where that we can hack, where that we can extend, For my customer, my day-to-day jobs, I'm customizing RCouch, the fork of CouchDB, for their own purpose, creating modules for their own purpose. And we are, I had always have to wrap some call in CouchDB to do the jobs, and it would be better to have a simpler API. We wanted also something to be, we wanted to be able to use CouchDB not only on HTTP, but using it with other transport if you want to. So, and we needed something without the extra, without the couch app part, without the proxy part, without the thing that are embedded in CouchDB. We wanted just the document storage and the view indexer storage. So for that, I extracted some code, take the couch core, removing all the extra, refactoring it so we can we don't have any file on that, refactoring some code so we don't use the HTTP API, and providing it as a library, which is Opencouch, which I demoed during the Erlang Factory in San Francisco this year. It works. I plan to do many things on that, but simply failed to do that because I didn't enjoy the job I had to do on that. I was redoing the work I did on RCouch, simply forking the CouchDB core once again, trying to work around or removing some code, etc. So more and more going a little further than CouchDB and doing a real fork. Which was quite annoying because some part of CouchDB code are ugly. So we have to rework that a lot of times. So one step further, at the end of April, I decided to give up any work on Opencouch and restart from scratch and started EnkyDB. So the EnkyDB is a document-oriented database too, with blob support, just like CouchDB, but with different with attachments, but with here with real blob support. We have three components in Enki, the peers, that are able to replicate between them and read and make queries on the storage, the editors, and the storage service. Basically, this is the design of Enki, which is quite similar to the one in Datomic, if you know it. Except we are using a document-oriented database here, and we are able to replicate the documents. So we have the peer here that are making transactions to the updater. The updater once the updater only manage transaction and write to a storage service. And storage service can be a local database, a local B3, or can be a remote database like DynamoDB or like React or whatever. We'll show you later the requirements. And peers do to the updater only write to the send transaction to the updater and read from storage service once they have been notified by the updater that a change happened on the storage services. And peers are also able to replicate between themselves and write locally, so you can still have the possibility to work offline with the peers. And when a peer has made a write locally and sent to the updater, the conflict will be handled by the updater transparently, or the updater will send a conflict to the peers, exactly like CouchDB, except we are working in with an updater that can be on different machine and the peers on different machine. So a peers is an Erlang library that you can embed in your Erlang application. So like I said, they are sending transaction to the updater. They are querying the storage services. They can edit locally the document, offline or not. They can replicate between peer and all the discovery of the updater. So you at one time, you have only one updater. So this is a trade-off between write and reads. We are considering that we don't want to care about logs, managing logs in real time. We don't want to have availability of the data. We want to have a strong consistency. So indeed, writes are slower, not so much slower because the updater only handling transactions, so this is quite fast. And it does one job, so because it does only one job, it's simpler to handle, so simpler to manage error, etc. The peers can also replicate from Apache CouchDB. There is no replication to CouchDB right now, but it should be possible. And a REST server exists in case you want to aggregate some peers around an HTTP API. You can simply use the peer REST server. And this is mostly an API like CouchDB, but a little difference. For the replication, CouchDB uses a revision tree. We try many solutions. The dotted vector clock, which is a new way that is used in React now, I think, or in React 2.0. I guess we saw mostly like vector clock, but except instead of having ID vector clock per clients, you have vector clock per server. So it reduces the size of your vector clock. Of your vector, or you have interval tree clocks, which is the other way, which is mostly like vector clocks, but you don't have to know all the nodes around to build your vector clock or replicate between the nodes. The ID of the vector clock is created dynamically if a node appears or disappears. So it can work in a decentralized way. But you still need to have a cluster around. So it wasn't fitted our real needs, and also I didn't have the time to investigate more the interval tree clock, but it could be a solution. A vector clock, dotted vector could work, but I wasn't pleased with the idea to pass a vector between each client rather than passing a simple revision like in CouchDB, a simple hash or ID that you pass, which is quite easier. So I set up to a revision tree with minor adjustments. Revision tree are simply a way to manage the relation between your edits. So when you edit, you pass a revision. Say I'm editing this revision. So it increases the branch in CouchDB by a new revision based on this branch. You do the same on each node. So if you are using the same revision, the branch continue to grow. And to select a winner, CouchDB will just take the longest branch, just like mostly like Bitcoin does to manage a winner between transactions. They are taking the transaction which have the longest history. We are doing it. We are doing the same for revision. Advantage of revision tree compared to the vector clock. Vector clock are fine because we have not so much edits. We are keeping them really compact, which is quite better when you want to pass the revision tree the information between nodes. But this is really hard to edit a vector clock. You have to dialogue with all the nodes around to edit your history in the vector clock, to change the causality and set which one is the real winner. Where in revision tree, you just have to remove a branch, edit a branch locally, and removing the revision, creating a new revision on top of that. We did minor adjustments. We added the concurrent edits concepts to the revision tree. Compared to CouchDB, where you increase the revision, each time you change, you increase the revision branch. Here, if you are doing a lot of change on the same branch in a short time, we are just increasing the number of edits of this revision, and the revision ID won't change. So we can keep the revision tree more compact than it was. Less unbalanced, less unbounded. Sorry. And we also wanted to have the revision tree working on the different revision storage. So the updater, like I said, manage only transactions, can accept, can manage conflicts via storage functions, can handle transaction functions. So like in Atomic, you have you can pass operation add and delay to get to the transactor. To the updater, but you can also pass functions in your transaction, And these functions take the latest database value, latest database states, on which you can query to retrieve the latest value from some data, and you return a list of new operations to the transaction list, which are handles right after. So you have, so a transaction function return a new set of add and delete operations on document on your database, and maybe other functions too that will be on that. This is much complicated than a giant server, but not much, not really much. The only addition are the way to manage transaction function and conflicts, storage function, sorry. To speak about data storage, I don't know how many time I have still. 5 minutes, okay. So CouchDB store document in two index. The revision, at least the revision tree is stored in two index. One indexing document by ID, one indexing document by sequence. So you can get a change log of your change in the database. And value of the revision tree are stored in the file, and the revision tree only keep reference in, inside. So a fake, if you are calling one revision, you are calling at any time the same part of the file system, so you can so it can be cached by your operating systems. And on because we are working on storage, we decided a different storage layer. We decided that the storage just need to provide a key value API with a CAS for updating, so a compare and switch function, so you are able to change the value of your attached to the key with a, without changing the key. Revision tree, instead of being revision tree are stored as a value, like in CouchDB, but instead of storing revision as part of the file system on the file, we are storing them at another value. So we have the same advantage, but we are storing them at immutable value in the database. We created different things for that, stuff that are open source, like CouchDB, which is a local storage engine, which is based on CouchDB B3, which is a pure Erlang, append-only B3, able to handle transactions, provide an easy API to store objects, in fact. You just simply objects, storing objects, deleting objects. CouchDB B3, like I said, is cow, append-only. You can store multi B3. So you can store the index and the sequence index in the same file, for example, and can use a lot of space need to compact. So our first attempt was to just extract the B3 part of CouchDB and making it as a library, which is CBT, that you can download here. This is not really usable by the end developer. You have to know what you are doing. Example, when you create a database, you are opening a file using the CBT file driver. You are creating a new B3 in the file. You initialize the B3, you add a data to the B3 using that functions, and you read the value. You read those. Yeah, title are not good. You are reading the stat in the B3, creating an header, and writing an header on your database, which is appended to your files. And the next times when you reopen the file, when you want to read, you reopen the file, read the header, so you have to know how you define your header, initialize the tree with the root that you store in your header, and then you can look up at your data, which is easy if you know how works the database. If you don't forget how to make it, you don't have any transactions, so you have to create your own transaction management. So it can be complicated. And so for that, we decided to create another small wrapper around all of that, which is named CouchDB, which is a wrapper on the CouchDB B3. Doesn't depend yet on CBT, but could be. And this is quite better. So we are creating a database file. Here, we initialize it using a function that can be in another modules. We are creating store there. We can initialize with data insights too during init. And when you want to look up, you just use lookup functions. When you want to remove, you can make transaction on that. You are saying add remove operation to your database. Then you can look up again, so you have the value stored. And we added, just for the sake of sanity, we added that transaction functions too. Like I described, it works exactly like a Yankee, we are sending a function, and this function returns a list of operations, here another operation. And when we look up for the value, you have the value that have been stored using transaction function. So Enki will be released under open source this month in open source license, and we will provide also paying support just for the library, a part of the main Camp.io service. And voilà. If you have any questions.
Well, we thank this speaker first.
Thank you.
And now, if you have questions, again, I will walk to you so that you can use the microphone. No? Everyone's eager to go to lunch, I guess. Okay. I have one maybe controversial question, and it's based on my own experience. So what happens usually to my students when they come to the moment they want to use a distributed database and they're using Erlang, as newbies and these links with the keynote talk that we had this morning, they make a few Google search and they find a number of things that to their eyes they seem very similar and they are forks of each other sometimes.
Yeah.
And it's really hard to them to decide where to start or how to compare those options that they find. What kind of advice would you give them? And what kind of advice would you give us as a community to solve that problem for newbies? So maybe what do we need to do?
For the best people, I mostly think about your strategy. If you want only more read than write, then you can choose the database you want. And yeah, mostly that. If you need transaction or not, if you need schema, that's the things to compare. And well, scalability. For example, if you take EnkiDB compared to CouchDB with the cluster things, we are doing a trade-off on writes, but you can still shard on application level if you want. But this is on an application level logic, not a server logic. That's it depends really what you want. Something fit you need, and if you want something to adapt. And yeah, this is why we're creating an EnkiDB. Yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering if you have any numbers on kind of the max number of the maximum data storage that you can have, or maximum number of records, or anything.
It really depends on the backend. If your data is small and you are storing it, I have no real proof today because we tested it, but not in production level. But we tested it on DynamoDB driver. Sending small data on that, and we were about able to send one million of records to that.
Right.
Using transactor I can't remember the time, but it was really short times.
Right. So what would you estimate, like one terabyte of data?
1 terabyte of data, certainly not. I don't think so.
Yeah.
But if you need 1 terabyte of data, you probably need to separate the editor or filter your data. Maybe shard it,
exactly.
Depending on your application logic.
I see. Thanks.
Any other question? Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.